Welcome to the Netsch Future Days 2022. Future Days, what does it mean? It's a series of presentations focusing on latest innovations from Netsch and possible future applications you can listen to within the next days. And today, we focus on pharmaceuticals and life science. We will get you an insight in latest applications, technical news, not only from Netsch, from our partners, as well as from our customers. And it's a great pleasure for me to introduce our business field manager, Dr. Gabi Kaiser, who will take over the lead over the first session and guide you through the program. I have to leave right now because I have later on a presentation from another location here in the building where you see latest news on differential scanning calorimetry. Gabi, your turn.
A warm welcome also from my part. The only constant in life is change. The quote from the Greek philosopher Heraclitus is already 2,500 years old. Nevertheless, it has lost none of its relevance. In the 21st century, industry has been confronted to increasingly complex and rapidly changing situations. However, alterations can open up a multitude of opportunities, especially if you have a partner at your side to assist you. Netsch is that partner who wants to support you in words and deeds. Therefore, let us discuss within the next approximately 1.5 hours how we can shape the future in the life science field together. The aspects which will be addressed are water and its influence on material properties. Water is omnipresent in the surroundings. However, if substances interact with water, their properties may be changed. And therefore, the first contribution of today is dealing with the question, how can we measure the capability of substances for sorption and desorption of water? Differential scanning calorimetry, or DSC for short, is the most frequently used thermoanalytical method for the characterization of pharmaceuticals. So I'm very proud to announce that you will witness today the introduction of an absolute novelty in this field. Look forward to it. To increase the comfort of patients with chronic diseases, depot systems for drug delivery are still evolving. New formulations of long-acting injectables are on the rise. DSC can be of great help to characterize drugs, the polymeric matrix, as well as, for example, microparticles. However, analytical techniques by Netsch can not only be applied to chemical, but also to biological samples. In vitro studies of blood, of peptides in solutions, etc., are of high interest. Rheometers are playing an important part in these investigations. Hear more about that in the interview with Alex Holder. But back to small molecules. Each large-scale design of a new or a revised synthesis step requires the determination of key parameters for thermal safety. Accelerating rate calorimetry is a method which can provide important information about it. Many drug substances are poorly soluble. To increase the solubility and thus also their bioavailability, various measures are taken. One of them is grinding. The NETCH grinding and dispersing business unit, the market leader in that field, will give us some insights into the wet grinding process under GMP conditions. What is not part of the program today, but what is indeed a recent trend is 3D printing. 3D printing is currently on everybody's lips. To reflect the importance of this topic, we have specifically dedicated one whole day for this purpose, and this is the fourth day of the NETCH Future Days. I would be happy if you stepped by as well. If you would like to communicate with us, please don't hesitate to do it. Your questions and comments are welcome. Please use for that the question window, which you can find on your screen. We are happy to answer your questions in the follow-up. Please find these answers on our website, futuredays-netch.com, under questions and recording. But let's get to our first contribution now. Moisture is more or less unavoidable. It's in the air we breathe and also a part of several process steps during drug manufacturing. However, the presence of water may influence the properties of drug or drug products. But how can we get information about the behavior of substances in a humid atmosphere? A simultaneous thermal analyzer, STA for short, in its standard version, usually measures DAC and TGA signals simultaneously on the same sample under identical conditions. But it can also quickly be converted into a sorption analyzer by connecting it to a suitable furnace and a so-called humidity generator. My colleague Roland Wetzel will now tell us more about it.
Thank you, Gabi. Now, in the next few minutes, we focus on the combination of thermal analysis with humidity to characterize pharmaceutical materials. As you all know, humidity surrounds us. We see it in clouds, we see it in the winter when we want to get rid of the ice on the windshield. But humidity and moisture will also influence materials on a daily basis. It affects in chemical or in the physical way. So you see it, for example, as cracks in the wall or when your material corrodes. When we talk about measurements under humidity, there are a lot of terms which are used. To refresh your knowledge, I just want to remember you some different phrases. So the first one would be relative humidity, which represents the content and the ratio of the water in respect to the maximum water we have in our system and at a certain temperature. The second term is the absolute water content or molar fraction, which equals to the concentration of water in your volume. And last but not least, the dew point. The dew point represents the temperature where water condensates out of the gaseous phase. So that's something you don't want to happen inside your device, because the formation of water droplets can affect your measurement and also, in the worst case, may damage your system. We here at NETCH offer different possibilities and measurement techniques which we can combine with a humidity generator. So the first one would be an STA, the second one a DMA, or last the TMA. So that's, we can characterize our materials regarding to changes in mass, changes in the elastic and viscous properties, or even in a change of sample dimensions depending on the presence of humidity. And today we just want to focus a little bit more on a combination with a humidity generator and an STA, which you can see here over here. Here we have an SDA449F3, where two different furnaces are equipped. So the first one is the normal SiC furnace, which you use for a common STA application. On the other side, you have here the copper furnace, which is used for the measurement under humid atmospheres. Next to the STA, we see the MHG, the humidity generator, which is connected to our copper furnace via a transfer line. And it's coming here to the mixing chamber. And now I just want to show you how easy it is to change your device from a common STA to a measurement system where you can measure your samples under humid atmosphere. So for that, you just open the STA. Swing the SiC furnace to the right so that the copper furnace is on top of the SDA, and then we can easily close back the furnace. So you saw that it's easy to change your system, and the measurement under humidity is especially in the application field of pharmacy and cosmetics of interest, because you have a lot of materials which can react with humidity. And in the worst case, you have changes in glass transition, so the formulation of your tablet can change. Also, degradation processes can happen when you have water next to your material. And in the worst case, you have maybe toxic degradation products which you don't want to have. Or even the shelf life decreases. Sometimes the reaction with humidity is also from interest. For example, when you take a look on the swelling of a tablet when the disintegrator reacts with the humidity. And just to take a look on an example for that, we have here the measurement results under defined humidity of a microcrystalline cellulose. And you see, you increase the relative humidity from 0 up to 80%, and subsequently you decrease the relative humidity again. And what you can see, for each different step you see the mass increases of your sample. And it reaches a plateau, and afterwards the humidity level was increased again, and the mass loss, mass increase was again detectable. And after you decrease the humidity again, you see that the mass will loss kind of in the same way as you saw it before. And at the end, you at the starting point, at the end point is almost the same. So that means your sample completely dissolved the water which is absorbed beforehand. You can easily see that in a desorption adsorption curve, where you can see regarding to the hysteresis, you can give an a statement regarding the hygroscopic properties, the stability, or even the crystallinity of your sample. Another sample example here would be the potassium clavulanate, which we stored under humid atmosphere in a really, really simple way. We just had a vessel full of potassium clavulanate and stored it for over a week over a water bath. And afterwards, the sample was investigated by a TGA and FJR combined measurement. And the result you can see here. So on top you see the TG curve, where you see the mass loss regarding temperature. You see you have one big mass loss step at around 100 degrees and several mass loss step higher than 200 degrees. And when you take a look on the results you get from the FTIR, you see that the mass loss at 100 degrees Celsius is regarding to the water dissolution. But also, when you take a look on the red curve on the bottom, which represents the intensity of the carbon dioxide bond, you see that there's also a signal. So even at 100 degrees, you can see the release of carbon dioxide. And also at higher degrees, a lot of more carbon dioxide is coming out of a sample because of the degradation. And just to take those two measurements into account, you can see and can understand even better the decomposition process of the potassium clavulanate. One side note, when you compare that result with a sample which you didn't had under humid atmosphere, so a completely dry sample, then you see that the carbon dioxide will release starting at 150 degrees or even higher, so not at 100 degrees C. You can also perform kinetic analysis using measurements which you did under humid atmosphere. For example, when you want to have more interest in the stability of the potassium clavulanate, and here you can see the kinetic results for different storage temperatures from 80 up to 150 degrees C. When you see the higher the temperature, the higher the mass loss. So that means you get a decrease in the stability of your potassium clavulanate at higher temperatures. So to sum the last few minutes up, I showed you that the humid conditions have a huge impact on the properties of your pharmaceutical materials and even the properties and influences in different ways. Also, when you combine a humidity generator with thermal analysis, you can have a deeper insight into the different changes of your material. I showed you also that it's really easy to change your SDA from a common SDA to a device which you can use to analyze reactions under humid atmosphere. And at the end, I showed you some examples out of a huge, huge application field where the measurements under humidity are of really big interest. I thank you and I wish you a good day.
Thank you very much, Roland, for this interesting contribution. The keynote of today is not a speech, but a colorful presentation in pictures. Let us switch now over to the auditorium, where my colleague Jürgen Blum will take you on a journey to new horizons in differential scanning calorimetry.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Today I have the pleasure to introduce some of the innovations of NETCH analyzing and testing. And I will focus on one method. I will show you four innovative products in the field of differential scanning calorimetry, DSCs. What are the four products? Coming to number one. And number one is the world's first multiple module differential scanning calorimeter. We all know DSCs, housing, sensor, furnace. Multiple module means you can get a DSC which can be equipped with different tailor-made modules fitting to your application. Specifically, we talk about modules which, for example, offers the world's most robust sensor system. So if you carry out OIT tests, or you worry about corrosive evaporations from your samples, this is a module of choice because it extends the lifetime of your system significantly. We have a module which offers highest sensitivity. So if you look for small, tiny little effects, this module is a one of choice for your application. We have a module which offers the highest heating and cooling rates, up to 500 Kelvin per minute up and down, which is most probably the world record for conventional heat flux DSCs. And we have a module which offers the broadest temperature range, from minus 180 all the way up to 750 degrees C. Multimodularity means even more. These modules are user interchangeable. So you can get a DSC with the perfect module for your application. You can even get a DSC with different modules. So you can always fit your DSC to a specific application on your own. You don't need two. You need one instrument with two modules. So it offers you highest possible flexibility. And it makes yourself ready for the future. Because if in 2, 3, or 4 years, a new module is launched, which matches your application even better, you don't have to change the DSC. Simply add the module and you are perfectly set up for the future. Product number two, a DSC featuring a completely new style of user interaction. Ease of use is always a topic we address. And there are mainly two components related to this. The first one is the LED light communication unit, which of course tells you something about the instrument status. Is it off? Is it on? Is it in the startup phase? It tells you whether you run out of purge gas or your cooling fluid is no longer available. And it gives you information about your measurement progress. There is an LED light bar integrated in the front side of the instrument, which indicates everything. Is my measurement done 25%, 50%, or already finished? You see it from far away where you are. You don't have to switch on the computer, put in the password, and look on the screen. You see it from 10 meters away, what's going on with your instrument. Part number two is an innovative touch interface. So there is a 7-inch touch interface integrated in the front side of the instrument, which of course allows you to put in some parameters or change a crucible. It of course allows you to start and stop a measurement. It furthermore gives you more detailed information about your measurement progress. And if your measurement is finished, it gives you a completely automatically evaluated result of your test. And this result is evaluated by the integrated artificial intelligence, which is based on various sophisticated mathematical routines. And this gives you peak temperatures, peak areas, completely objective without user interaction. And of course, you see whether the measurement is okay or not. Coming to the third innovation, and this is related to data treatment. We have a DSC with integrated search engines and an unmatched connectivity to the world. Intelligent data processing. So we have a database integrated in the software of this DSC, which contains more than 2,000 entries, literature curves, which are stored there and which can be used to identify your measurement on an unknown material. More than 2,000 literature entries. But you not only depend on literature. The search engine even allows to match or search for any historical measurement you have carried out on this instrument. So you can look for measurements which were done by the same operator, or with the same sample name, or under the same project number, and the system automatically finds it on your computer. And there's a third part related to ease of use. This is our one-touch statistics. Of course, we can evaluate peak temperatures, or a shoulder, or an area, but we drove it even further on. So if you want to do an uncertainty determination of your measurement result, you simply have to press one button. If you have carried out multiple measurements and you want to do an averaging, press one button and you have the answer. Simple operation. This is one of the topics related to this part. Coming to the second part, this is connectivity. And we have a DSC which has an integrated LabV interface. What means LabV? LabV is a data management system for your laboratory, where you can store all data you have carried out in the lab. Not only DSC data, not only thermal analysis data, we're talking about all measurement methods you have available in your laboratory, and you can store the data there. And of course, central database makes it easy to manage projects. So you can store and sort your results according to projects, and it's easy to access and to see what was done under a certain project name. And we have a global access. This database is a cloud solution, which is not only limited to your local laboratory. You can store there all the data available in your laboratories around the globe. And it goes in the other direction as well. When you want to access the database, you can do it from everywhere where you are in the world, as long as you have an internet connection. So when you have to prepare a presentation or you are in a discussion, you always have access to your measurement results. Product number four. A DSC, which always works optimum even under harsh environments. Sometimes we have to locate our DSC close to the production environment for quality control. And you have machines there generating noise, generating vibrations. Or you have to locate a DSC on a shaky table, or you have a lot of traffic, people in your laboratory touching the instrument. And we all know this. This can generate steps or spikes in the curves, which sometimes results in the fact that we have to repeat the tests. Our engineers have addressed this issue, and we have developed the so-called levitation unit. And the levitation unit separates the instruments more or less from the table. By magnetic levitation, our instrument sits on an air cushion and is no longer in direct contact with the table below. This, of course, eliminates external influences. And even a small earthquake doesn't matter anymore. Less steps, less spikes, less repeat measurements means more efficiency for your laboratory. So let me summarize. Four products. The world's first multiple module DSC. A DSC featuring a completely new style of user interaction and ease of use. A DSC with integrated databases, search engines, and an unmatched connectivity to the world. And finally, a DSC which is sensitive only where it matters. And in fact, I was not talking about four products. I was talking about one. And the one is a new NETCH DSC 300 Kaleyrus. The DSC 300 Kaleyrus is not only a new instrument. It's not only representing the state of the art in ease of use, robustness, and sensitivity. We are sure the DSC 300 Kaleyrus represents the future of differential scanning calorimetry. And today is the day where future gets reality. Hey, Kaleyrus. And now show me your face. Thank you very much.
Wow, Jürgen, very impressive. A new device that raises precise and reliable measurements on different kinds of materials, of course, also on pharmaceuticals, on a new level. One application example which can be carried out by using such device will now be presented by my colleague Lisha de Souza. She will speak about formulations which provide a controlled drug release over time and how to characterize them. Please, Lisha, go ahead.
Thank you, Gabi. Today I'll talk about the use of differential scanning calorimetry in the characterization of drug delivery systems. Long-acting injectable or depot delivery systems are parenteral formulation intended for prolonged or sustained drug delivery over a long period of time. The aim of using such a system is decreasing the dose frequency and simplifying the drug regimen, hence improving patients' compliance and increasing efficacy of the treatment. These systems offer adjustable, controlled, and continuous drug release up to several months, being therefore advantageous for the treatment of chronic diseases or when a medicine is needed to be administered for a long period of time. Based on different materials like polymer, lipophilic or hydrophilic gels, or even liquid crystals, they can be used to encapsulate lipophilic small molecules, as well biotechnology-based drugs as peptides, antibodies, and enzymes. Nowadays, several long-acting delivery systems are commercially available for the treatment of different conditions. Most of these formulations have the polylactic coglycolic acid, PLGA, as a matrix. Biodegradable polyester, PLGA, is highly attractive material for the controlled and sustained release of both low molecular weight drugs and macromolecules. The drug release rate and the polymer degradation rate can be turned from days to months by changing the size or geometry of the systems or the chemical composition of the polymer, like monomer ratio or the molecular weight of the polymer or the chemistry of the end group. However, undesired nonlinear drug delivery profiles, including burst release and lag times, are frequently observed with PLGA. The systems are successfully applied in psychiatric illness, namely schizophrenia and bipolar disorder, improving the patient's adherence of the treatment. Risperidone-loaded PLGA microparticles was the first long-acting injectable formulation of an atypical antipsychotic approved by FDA. It's administered through intramuscular injection every 2 weeks, being a big step towards the efficacy of the treatment. However, due to the lag phase, the therapy scheme requires the oral supplementation for the first 3 weeks. This is obviously a downside of this formulation. One attempt to overcome this drawback was the production of the microparticles, the risperidone microparticles, not with PLGA, but with PEG PLGA. The introduction of a hydrophilic polymer like polyethylene glycol into the polymer backbone gives a linear drug release over 1 month without any signs of lag phase in vitro. The most common procedure to prepare such microparticles is the emulsification procedure. In this method, the polymer and the drug are solubilized in an organic solvent. This organic solution is then emulsified in an aqueous phase. The organic solvent is eliminated by evaporation or extraction, and the hardened particles are then washed and freeze-dried. The system shown here was prepared with PEG PLGA, with molecular weight in the range of 60 to 85 kilodaltons, containing 5% of PEG. And risperidone, a white crystalline solid with melting point at 170 degrees C. Let's see the DSC results. PEG PLGA is an amorphous substance with glass transition at 38.5 degrees C. The sample showed a relaxation peak at 46 degrees C. Relaxation peak is related to the elimination of mechanical stress or dissolving of order domains. And among other factors, it depends on the storage conditions. For example, the longer the polymer is stored at temperatures close to the glass transition temperature, the higher this relaxation peak will be. This curve shows the cooling curve and the second heating curve showed only glass transition. Risperidone presented a melting peak at 171.9 degrees C and extrapolated onset at 169.9 degrees C. This is in agreement with the theoretical value. It's important to say that no mass loss was observed, which is an indication that no chemical degradation happened under these experimental conditions. The slope at the beginning of the melting point in the first heating, as well as the profile of cooling and second heating curves, may be attributed to the presence of byproducts, given that the risperidone sample has a purity of 95%. The DSC curve of physical mixture between polymer and drug is shown here in purple, and it's an overlay of the polymer and drug curves. The Proteus software has a useful tool called superposition. After selecting the DSC curves of individual substance, the software calculates the physical mixture curve if no chemical reaction happens between both substances. Here I have defined the composition of the mixture, and we see in the experimental curve in purple and the calculated curve in blue that both agree very well. Finally, the PEG PLGA risperidone microparticles. In the first heating, glass transition temperature is seen at the range of 42 degrees C and a peak at 50.7 degrees C. the melting peak of risperidone is not present. In the second heating and the cooling, in the cooling curves, we see only glass transition. In such a systems, polymer and drug mixture can exist in three different states: as a molecular dispersion, where the drug is at or below the equilibrium solubility in the polymer, or as amorphous solid dispersion, where the drug is in amorphous state dispersed in the drug matrix, or third, as a crystalline suspension, where the drug is in its crystalline state dispersed inside the polymer matrix. Further, the drug release profile is influenced by the physical location of the solid state forms throughout the polymer matrix. That can be a uniform drug distribution or segregated drug domains. We clearly see here in this comparison of polymer, physical mixture, and microparticles the change in the risperidone solid state. Summing it up, this result suggests that in this system we don't have a crystalline dispersion. Instead, we have here likely an amorphous or a molecular dispersion. Besides, the impact of manufacturing process on the characteristics of individual components of a formulation and the change on glass transition temperature and melting and crystallization behavior of these components in the final formulation are easily accessed by DSC analysis. DSC is a sensitive and reliable technique for the determination of solid state properties of drugs and pharmaceutical excipients. And it's of great help on the development of the new drug delivery systems. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Lisha. Biopharmaceuticals based on large molecules are becoming more and more important, and COVID vaccines have given this field an additional boost. Alex Holder from Swansea University will now give us an overview on various applications on biological materials using rheometers. The interviewer will be my colleague Shona Marsh.
Hi, I'm Dr. Shona Marsh, and I am the Applications and Product Marketing Manager for Rheology, and I'm joined today by Dr. Alex Holder from the University of Swansea. Today we're going to have a little bit of an overview of this instrument. Alex is going to show you what we've got set up at the moment so we can change what we call the geometries that are used to test our materials. So Alex, if you can show how we go about changing those geometries, taking the upper geometry out and swapping it to something different.
Yeah, absolutely. So like you say, the great thing about these combined motor transducer rheometers is that everything is up here. Both the measurement and the motor is at the top spot. So this top geometry is really critical, and being able to change that's very important. At the moment, I've got a cone loaded on here, which creates an even shear profile across the sample because of the angle of the the angle of the geometry itself. But for certain materials, it's more important to have a good adhesion to the plate. So sometimes we use roughened geometries, and sometimes we'll deal with materials that are that change so dramatically throughout a test that we have to dispose the geometry entirely, and we have to use a disposable plate. But I've just taken the cone off, and I can put the roughened geometry easily in just like that, and then I'll receive a prompt from the machine to go ahead and zero the gap, which we'll go ahead and do now.
So not only can we change those measuring interfaces and those geometries that we use to measure our materials with, we can also swap out the different cartridges, what we call cartridges. So that's that lower component that we work with. So at the moment, we've got a plate system. You can operate with what's called cup and bob systems, or we can even configure different accessories on, such as UV cells, if we're looking to study UV curing materials. So Alex, you've got one of those, haven't you, to hand?
Yes, I've been looking at UV materials. So this literally just pulls out easy as you like. And then I've got a UV base here, which is just a transparent plate. And this is a borosilicate disc. But we have a quartz disc as well, if the wavelengths of the light need to be different. So we have a quartz disc. And then we can simply apply a UV light through a light box through the base of this and apply rheological measurements simultaneously to the material as light hits it. And UV materials change really, really rapidly indeed. So it's important to have that simultaneous measurement.
What sort of UV materials have you been looking at? What sort of applications is this useful for?
Well, at the moment, I'm looking at more industrial applications. UV is typically used in graphics inks and electronics coatings. That's at the moment. And that's what you're really looking at, is forming a solid boundary that will protect electronics, that will quickly adhere inks very, very rapidly. And that's where the UV polymers shine. They're very, very rapid transformation from liquid to solid. But the future applications of UV polymers are really in things like 3D printing, where we've already looked at things like bioscaffolds and building bespoke material, building bespoke materials quickly and rapidly. And that's where UV materials are really, really useful. The difficulty with measuring the materials themselves is that exact same problem, is the rapidity of the change. So at the moment, in terms of industry, what we tend to look at is we just apply as much light as quickly as possible and see the change happen as fast as possible. But we don't really understand the mechanical processes that undergo, other than we know what the polymer looks like as a liquid and we know what the polymer looks like as a solid. But that transition, that what we call a sol-gel transition, is really underreported. And that's where this machine comes in, because it can tell us more about how that material changes.
What other sort of materials can we measure as biorheologists on this instrument? What sort of information can we get from it? I know you've done some previous work with blood and mucus or sputum. So can you tell us a little bit about that, and perhaps even show us how you would go about loading one of these materials onto your instrument there?
Sure. So low viscosity materials are really, really suited to, like, say, stress controlled instruments, because, as you said before, these machines are really, really sensitive to small forces. So when you're dealing with something like blood, you're looking at really quite a transient material that goes from something that's very water-like to something that's really, really rigid and strong quite rapidly. The coagulation cascade is obviously a complex series of chemical reactions. But it's quite a dramatic change mechanically. I've done quite a lot of work with low viscosity gelling systems, as well as collagen, et cetera. And loading the machine like this is really, really very simple. Just on the software, there's a load sample prompt, and then I'll be prompted to enter sample details, which I'm going to put in here, and set a working gap. Obviously, the gap is very, very important. If you don't have a large enough gap, you won't get bulk properties of your material. If your gap is too large, you're going to be looking at inertial problems with the material. So with low inertial problems, especially biosamples, the difficulty with gap is you want a small enough gap that you get very, very accurate responses from your material, from your machine, but you don't want it so small that you're not looking at the bulk properties of that liquid. So we take is a criterion where we want to make sure that we have at least 10 times the largest particle in that sample as a gap, as an absolute minimum gap. So we don't go lower than that. But I'm going to use 1 millimeter on here simply because it's a nice round number. And again, it's just going to tell me to load the sample. I have my sample here, and just load it there simply. And then the head will come down on that sample and hopefully fill the void.
So what other challenges of measuring things like blood, because you know, if we get, for example, bubbles in blood, or we have to act quite quickly, don't we, if we're working with live blood samples?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, what's really interesting is with blood, you have, it's obviously oxygenated, it's got a lot of gas in there. So when you take a live blood sample from someone, you have to deal with the fact that there's going to be gas in that sample. As it coagulates, as it clots, you're going to find that that gas escapes the sample, and so often you can see bubbles forming in your sample as it coagulates, which is a nightmare in terms of good resolution of data, because a bubble always comes out as a viscoelastic solid, which is obviously not what you want. So that's obviously one of the challenges. Another interesting challenge with blood is that it's hard, obviously, once you've taken it from a person, that coagulation cascade, that process of clotting has already begun. So you need to immediately get it on a rheometer or citrate that blood to prevent the coagulation cascade from continuing. But in citrating blood, you're diluting it. And then to restart the coagulation cascade, you need to recalcify that blood. Because in citrating blood, you're taking the calcium it needs to clot out of it. So you have to then re-add that calcium to get that clot to continue. And when you essentially mess around with the coagulation cascade so much and you add so many dilutants, you're not getting an accurate representation of the mechanical properties and the mechanical processes of clotting. So you essentially have two options. You can deal with citrated blood as a good approximation of blood, or you can deal with fresh blood and essentially race against time in terms of getting it on a rheometer and measuring the properties quickly enough. So there's a lot of challenges when you're dealing with biofluids. Another big challenge with the biofluids, of course, is that everyone's blood is different. We've had people's whose blood vary day to day. I'll tell you, I could tell you if I'd span your blood down from plasma today, I could tell you if you ate vinegar yesterday, because your plasma would be more discolored than it would usually. So there's a tremendous amount of variation just naturally in intra people and inter people, you know. So there's
can you tell if I've eaten copious amounts of chocolate?
I don't know about chocolate, but salt, vinegar and alcohol were almost always evident. Interestingly, alcohol seemed, I mean, this is almost anecdotal, we never really found a good correlation, but it seemed like alcohol really inhibited how your blood clotted to us.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, blood, is it a Newtonian material, would you say?
It's what's really fantastic about blood is, as a liquid, it's one of the most easiest to pump liquids. It's a Newtonian, almost the viscosity of water, really, really processable liquid, you know, which is a fantastic property of the bioliquid. And then the second it starts clotting, it becomes really, really rigid and strong.
So we should probably elaborate on what the definition of Newtonian means for people who don't have any familiarity with that.
So this is a Newtonian liquid, which is essentially, this is a water with a slight dilutant added. And this is a Newtonian liquid. And like you say, Newtonian liquids flow irrespective of shear profile. They have a linear shear profile, like you say. You apply a low shear, they have a response. You apply a high shear, they have the exact same response in proportion. You know, so they have a very similar reaction. But then you have materials that are, like you say, non-Newtonian, that are more complex.
Would this maybe be something similar to sputum or mucus? Would you say is classed as a viscoelastic non-Newtonian?
Absolutely. Sputum mucus is a viscoelastic material. You have, it's almost like it's at essentially viscoelasticity at long time scales or at certain time scales, it acts like a material will act more liquid-like, and at short time scales or any other time scales, it will act more solid-like. Typically, it's short to long. So if you have, typically materials will act more liquid-like the longer time you give them, i.e. if you have a material that's viscoelastic, usually it will flow over the course of a day, but it won't flow over the course of 10 seconds, if that makes sense. A good example of this is this putty that I have handed to me from Netsch. And essentially, if I pull it apart slowly, it acts like a liquid. It will deform happily. It will fill a cup. It will fill a jar. But if I pull it apart quickly, it just snaps and forms quite a rigid break. So it's liquid-like at long timescales and solid-like at short timescales. And where that applies to biofluids and sputum is that sputum, it flows down your gullet. It will move over time. But if you cough, i.e. a short timescale rapid force, it's solid-like. It will come up. It will move. And that's what's really interesting about mucus is it has these properties that are almost designed for its purpose. At long time scales it will flow, and at short time scales it will act rigid and not move at all.
So both of these materials that we're describing are things that can be measured on the rheometer. We can obtain this information about how viscous or whether they are Newtonian or non-Newtonian through this rotational rheometer.
Yeah, absolutely. So what this machine will do is it'll actually oscillate, applying what we call a linear viscoelastic measurement on the material. And it oscillates at any time scale you want to investigate. And we do that in hertz. So 1 hertz is 1 second, 10 hertz is a tenth of a second, and 0.1 hertz is 10 seconds long. And essentially what it does is it rocks the material back and forward. It applies a force on that material and unapplies it in the opposite direction. And it essentially measures how receptive or non-receptive to that time scale the material is. And you'll find that over the range of frequencies that this machine can operate, you'll find that you'll see more solid-like or more liquid-like responses based on what frequencies you're applying.
Have you tested in the field of biorheology? Is there anything related to collagen or tissue scaffolds that you've been involved with?
Yeah, we've looked at rat tail collagen sort of housed within almost like a cell culture medium. So what we were trying to do is create an environment, a collagen environment in which cells could grow, but within the rheometer. And we had a custom unit around the machine which applied carbon dioxide and kept everything warm, so that in theory we could grow cells and apply, you know, the rheometry simultaneously and see what cell growth looked like mechanically within cell culture scaffolds. We looked at, you know, the effect of gelling of collagen gels at different temperatures and different structures that were created by the collagen. And then ideally what we wanted to do was investigate what happens when we seed those different collagen structures with cells. Usually biomaterials are within the realm of, you know, low to moderate viscosity, low to moderate strength. And that's where these stress controlled instruments or these combined motor transducer machines really shine. They don't need to apply large forces to get the responses we need.
Well, thank you so much for your time, Alex. In that time that we've been talking, is the same amount of time that we would have had to run a measurement. So could you quickly show us how we go about unloading the sample and removing it from the instrument?
Absolutely. It's just as simple as pressing an unload prompt on the software, and then the machine will simply raise up, and then I'll clean my sample off, and then I should be ready to go to load another one.
So thank you so much for your time today, Alex. It's been a pleasure talking to you, and it's been incredible to learn about all these different biomaterials and how we can use a rheometer to study them. So I hope we get a chance to talk again, and look forward to hearing from you soon.
Oh, great, Shona. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Shona, and thank you very much, Alex Holder. But back to small molecules. Before we talk about the formulation or the administration of drug products, the ingredients must first be manufactured. When developing new synthesis processes on a large scale or moving production from one location to another, thermal safety is an issue that must be considered. Key parameters such as TMR or TMR 24 hours are of high interest in that area. My colleague Eckhard Füglein, who has been dealing with such questions for a longer time, will now enlighten what is behind these terms and how these parameters can be determined. Hello, Eckhard. Nice to have you here today. As mentioned already in the introduction, thermal safety plays an important role in chemical processes and, of course, also in the manufacture of drugs. Which options does NEDGE offer to make the production of drugs safer?
Yes, you're right. Safety is crucial in all areas of production. No matter if we focus on the chemicals, the production itself, or disposal. And so NEDGE offers equipment for the simulation of thermal runaways and worst case scenarios.
Mm-hmm. Would you please be so kind as to tell us a little bit more about what worst case scenario mean?
Okay, worst case scenario in this context means the temperature of a reactor. Chemical reactions are usually done isothermally. Mm-hmm. And the heat which is produced through the reaction is compensated by a cooling system.
Mm-hmm.
And reactions usually generate a lot of heat, so it means it is necessary to compensate for that through the cooling. And worst case scenario or a worst case can occur if there is no compensation for the cooling. So this means if a pump fails, for instance, then there is no balance of the heat production of the chemical reaction.
Mm-hmm. So you mentioned that it's no longer possible to compensate for the heat of reaction via the cooling system if a reactor is out of control. So the temperature keeps rising. And what does this mean finally, that the reactor explodes?
Yes, in the worst case, this may happen. And it was already the case in history that terrible accidents happened. So from this point, it's even more important to detect the earliest point of a runaway. So this means the lowest temperature of a runaway. And if the temperature is the driving force for the reaction, so the higher the temperature, the faster the reaction. So this means it is a self-accelerating process. And this is what we call a thermal runaway. And the aim is to detect this thermal runaway as early as possible, so as at lowest temperature.
Mm-hmm. In practice, how we can recognize as early as possible whether a process is about to get out of control?
Yeah, so this is, as I mentioned, via temperature. So we can simulate those kind of controlled explosions in our calorimeters. Mm-hmm. And the calorimeter we use here is the ARC-254. ARC stands for accelerating rate calorimeter.
Mm-hmm.
And we can see the whole instrument here on the left side, and on the right side, a typical sample container with a diameter of 2.5 centimeter or 1 inch. And the experiments are, of course, carried out in a smaller scale.
Mm-hmm. And what does small scale mean here in this context?
Okay, small means in this context 2.5 centimeters in diameter makes a typical sample volume of around about 5 milliliter.
Mm-hmm.
And 5 milliliter with a density of 1 in case of water, for instance, means 5 gram.
Mm-hmm.
And this is already remarkable. So if we compare this with DSC experiments, where we usually use crucibles with 5, 10, 15 milligram, 5 gram or 5,000 milligram is already quite a lot of substance. So the sample container is then inside the equipment surrounded by several heaters. And as soon as we detect this temperature rise caused by the sample reaction, the heaters are tracking the sample temperature.
So early detection is carried out through temperature measurement.
Exactly. If we don't allow the sample to dissipate heat, a failure of cooling is simulated. So the sample gets warmer and warmer, the reaction gets faster and faster, and it accelerates. So this is what we call a runaway, and the system is adiabatic, which means that it's not able to dissipate heat. So this is really the worst case we simulate, and the typical reaction is then the self-heating, so that the sample reaction itself accelerates the speed of reaction.
Mm-hmm. Is other data besides the temperature detected during such measurement with an accelerating rate calorimeter?
Yes, indeed, pressure. I didn't mention it yet, but this is at least as important as temperature, because many decomposition reactions produce gases, and this causes a pressure increase inside the container, and we can measure this pressure since the vessel is connected to a pressure gauge.
Mm-hmm. Can you please give us a brief impression of what a typical measurement result is, looks like?
This figure shows a measurement result on DDPP, which is an organic peroxide, using our ARC-254. Peroxides are well known as bleaching agents or disinfectants. Mm-hmm. And organic peroxides are also well known or taken for radical starting reactions like polymerization. And from these examples, it can be seen that it's not necessarily that we are talking about explosives or highly dangerous materials, but rather more everyday substances or processes. And the temperature rise we can see here in red on this example, and the pressure in blue. So this means that we stepwise lift the temperature and check whether there is an additional heat generation by the sample reaction or not. And this cascade of stepwise heating is called heat weight surge. Mm-hmm. And if there is an additional heat production from the sample, then this heat weight surge cascade is stopped and it changes into the adiabatic mode, which means that the heaters are tracking the sample temperature.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's remarkable. But back to the temperature difference, isn't there also an adiabatic temperature difference? Because you mentioned the term adiabatic already before.
Yeah, there is a distinction between the measured temperature increase, which we call delta T observed or measured, and the delta T adiabatic. And the difference is the influence of the container. Mm-hmm. So this that it's necessary to put the sample into a container, and the container has a certain influence. The measure for this influence is the so-called phi factor, where we have the mass and specific heat capacity of the sample on one side and mass and specific heat capacity of the container at the other side. And since there is no reaction without container, the container always has an influence. And this is the reason why we distinguish between observed and adiabatic temperature rise.
Okay, okay. Does this mean that the accelerating rate calorimeter, so this ARC-254 instrument, is not ideally adiabatic?
Actually, no measurement equipment can be ideally adiabatic, since all measurements need the container. So we always have the influence of the container. And therefore, it's necessary to know mass and specific heat capacity of both the container and the sample.
By means of this information, you know what temperature increase to expect in a worst case. What does this mean for the cooling circuit or for the defective pump?
Yeah, by knowing this temperature increase under adiabatic conditions, it's possible to calculate the worst case or the amount of heat which is produced, and therefore these values are taken to design reactors or cooling capacities. And to stop the reactor from getting out of control, or in the case of a thermal runaway, it's necessary to fully balance the heat production of the reaction. And in practically, it's the easiest way to overcome such a failure of a cooling device is to equip the unit with an additional pump or with a redundant pump, which can easily be switched on automatically in such a case.
Okay. One value we have not yet discussed is TMR 24 hours. What's it all about?
Yeah, we have seen on the previous slide the adiabatic temperature rise of runaway reaction. And if we rescale this adiabatic segment into a logarithmic time scale, we can extrapolate the data from the adiabatic segment into the direction of a longer time and lower temperature. Mm-hmm. And at 24 hours extrapolation, we find finally the temperature at which it takes 24 hours to reach the maximum reaction speed. And this is the time to maximum rate, 24 hours. Mm-hmm. It's usually taken as an important criterion for safety. Usually there is another 10 degrees lower, which is stated to be a safe temperature for storage, for instance.
Mm-hmm. Very interesting. Thank you very much, Eckart, for this comprehensive information, which gave us revealing insights into the area of thermal safety. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
So welcome back. In the next presentation, we will see something from our business unit partner, grinding and dispersing. There will be a presentation on the fine grinding of active pharmaceutical ingredients. And Sven Hoffmann, our colleague from there, will give us some overview what they are doing in the pharmaceutical field.
I hope you enjoyed the first day of the NETCH Future Days. Thank you very much for your interest, and thank you, Jürgen, very much for being with us. Have a nice rest of the day, and perhaps we will meet again tomorrow where the focus is energy storage and insulation.